Hello learners, welcome to NIOS Studio. Today we are going to start a topic, nutrition and digestion. Now what is meant by nutrition? The food that we take in, or any organism, the food that he or she takes in constitutes the nutrition. That is, we can define nutrition as, it's a process by which organism obtains and utilizes food for their growth, development and maintenance. For what we require food, that is for the development and the maintenance of the body. Now, what is digestion? Digestion is a process of breaking down of complex constituents of food with the help of enzymes into simpler soluble forms that can be absorbed and utilized by the cells of the body. So, digestion is basically the breakdown of food so that it can be absorbed by the body and ultimately assimilated for the growth and development. Now, the nutrition can be of two types basically, autotrophic and heterotrophic. Autotrophic means all the green plants. Auto means the self and troph means the food. All the green plants and certain bacteria which manufacture their own food with the help of inorganic substances, carbon dioxide, water and sunlight. Green plants, you all know, they contain a pigment which helps in capturing the sunlight, and with the help of carbon dioxide and water, they change it into the glucose molecule. Then heterotrophic nutrition, hetero means the different and troph is a food. So the organisms which depend upon the autotrophs for requirement of the food or on the other heterotrophs. Now, food, organic and inorganic substances obtained by feeding on other organisms. That is how we can define an heterotrophic nutrition. Now, heterotrophic nutrition can again be of three types, that is the holozoic, saprophytic and parasitic. Holozoic is the organisms which engulf the food into the body, digest it and absorb the soluble products of digestion. As in humans, we have a holozoic mode of nutrition. Then saprophytes. Saprophytes are the organisms which depend on dead and decaying matter. We can say they are the ones who clean the earth. Organisms, they secrete the digestive enzymes onto the dead organic material and absorb the product of digestion. And the example of the saprophytes are the fungi and the bacteria. Then the third mode of nutrition is the parasitic. Parasitic organisms, they depend on other organisms for their food and ultimately they harm them. The food is derived from other living organism on or inside their body. Like you know of the roundworm, tapeworm, and then in plants it is the cuscuta. Now, what are the major components of food? What are the chemical substances which make up the food are? Basically, the three main components of any food is the carbohydrates, fats and proteins. Now, what are carbohydrates? Carbohydrates as well as fats and proteins, they all are the organic compounds. The carbohydrates are the compounds of hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen. And the example of the most common carbohydrate is the glucose or the sugars that we take, starches, fiber, and they are found in grain, fruits, vegetables. Most of the foods that we eat or any organism eat contains the carbohydrates. Then proteins. Proteins are again the organic compounds which are made up of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and besides that they contain another element, that is the nitrogen. And the rich source of proteins are the milk, beans, all the pulses and legumes, they are rich source of proteins. Now, the third is the fats. Fats are made up of fatty acid and glycerol. They are again organic compounds which are rich in carbon and hydrogen and they have very little oxygen. And they are insoluble in water. Example of fats are all oils that we consume for cooking our food. And the most common one is the coconut oil. So, the basic components of any food are carbohydrates, fats and proteins. Besides, the food also contains minerals, vitamins, which are very essential for the body function of any organism. Now let's move on to the digestion and what are the steps of the holozoic digestion in holozoic organisms. First, there are major 5 steps in the digestion process. First is the ingestion. Ingestion is taking in of food, chewing or sucking or swallowing. That will all constitute the ingestion. Then comes the digestion. Digestion is once we take in the food is converted into smaller or simpler absorbable form. That is the digestion. Absorption. That is absorbing the digested food from the gut to reach the body tissues. So once the food has been digested, that small particles or the small molecules have been made, say in the case of proteins, it is amino acids, in case of carbohydrates, it is the monosaccharides, mostly glucose, galactose or fructose, and in case of fats, it is fatty acid and glycerol. They are all absorbed in our small intestine. So that is the process of absorption. The next step in the holozoic digestion is the assimilation. Assimilation is the utilization of the digested food nutrients by the body tissues. Once the absorbed material reaches the cells, in cells the further breakdown takes place to release the energy or for the bodybuilding process, that constitutes the assimilation. Then the last step is the ejection. Ejection is the removal of the waste or the undigested food from the body. And for this ejection process, the fibers, they play a very important role. So whatever diet that you should take should always be rich in fibers so that the digestive process functions properly. Now, what are the types of digestions in heterotrophs? It can be intracellular or extracellular. Now, what do we mean by an intracellular digestion? Intra means within. So all the five steps of digestion, as we have discussed earlier, like ingestion, digestion, absorption, assimilation, and ejection, when they take place inside the cell only, then it is an intracellular digestion. The example of intracellular digestion is the amoeba, paramecium. Amoeba and paramecium are the protozoans, and any free living unicellular organism, they show the intracellular digestion, because one cell, they are unicellular and all the life processes are being taken care by that particular cell. Now moving on to the extracellular digestion. Extracellular digestion, the example is all the animals, they show the extracellular digestion, multicellular animals. Now digestion occurs outside the cell. That too in a tube-like structure or a canal or a cavity. Maybe you must have seen the alimentary canal, in the structure of the alimentary canal in the books, and it appears to be a tube-like structure open at two ends. One is at the mouth and other is at the anus. Besides this intracellular and extracellular digestion, there are few organisms like Hydra which show both the types of digestion in one organism, intra as well as extracellular. The example is Hydra. They capture the food with the help of tentacles on their body. They digest it in the cavity in their body, and part of the digestion also takes place inside the cells lining the cavity. Now, the example of the intracellular digestion, I can show you through a diagram. This is an amoeba, and as you can see, there is a red colored bacterium. Around the bacterium, there are two structures protruding out. You know that amoeba, it forms a pseudopodia. Pseudopodia is a false foot. These two structures which are protruding out are the false foot or the pseudopodia. Now, ultimately, in the next step, you have seen that it has rounded off the bacteria through its pseudopodia into the cell and forms a phagosome. Then lysosome releases the enzymes into the phagosomes and make it a phagolysosome. These enzymes, like ingestion has taken place in the first step, then now the digestion with the help of an enzyme is going on. All the nutrients which are required will be taken up by the cells, and the waste has been thrown out as a soluble debris, or the process is known as the exocytosis, which we call as ejection. So as you can see in the amoeba, all the five steps of digestion are being taken care of by a single cell. Now, let's move on to the extracellular digestion, and in this we'll take up the human alimentary canal. The structures which are required for the digestion are the alimentary canal organs and the glands associated with it. This is the structure of a human alimentary canal. You can see the first part is the oral cavity. In that you can also see a tongue and certain glands, that is the salivary glands, parotid, submaxillary and sublingual, which are present around the oral cavity. Then there is a tube-like structure extended from the mouth, an esophagus. Beneath the esophagus, you can see a round J-shaped structure. The color of that stomach, that is the stomach, and it is, the color is exactly same as that of the esophagus. Over the stomach, there is a leaf-like structure with the veins that we see in the leaf are present on that, and that is the pancreas. Over the stomach, you can see a gland, the liver. Beneath the liver, there is a green structure known as the bile duct, and the secretion of the liver and the pancreas, both these glands are thrown into the duodenum through a common duct known as the hepatopancreatic duct. The stomach extends into a small intestine. Small intestine has three parts, duodenum, jejunum and the ileum. The small intestine then moves on to the large intestine, and ultimately the waste product is ejected through a anus. The first structure is the mouth. Mouth contains the teeth. The teeth, they help in breaking down the food into smaller particles. Why do we need to break the food into smaller particles? So that the enzymes can act on it by increasing the surface area, and the digestion can go on in a better way. Then comes the work of the tongue. Tongue mixes the food with saliva, which contains the enzyme salivary amylase. This particular enzyme works at pH around 8, 7 to 8, and they help in breaking down the carbohydrates. The third structure present is the epiglottis. It's a flap-like structure at the back of the throat, and it closes over the trachea so that the food doesn't enter into a windpipe. Then after the mouth comes the pharynx. Pharynx is a common tube-like structure or a common passage for the air and the food. After pharynx is an esophagus, as I have already discussed. It is again a tube which moves food from pharynx to the stomach using muscle movement called peristalsis. And it also secretes the mucus. Mucus is a substance which protects the inner lining of our esophagus, stomach and small intestine. Then after esophagus, the food, that is a bolus, passes on to a stomach. You can see the structure of a stomach beneath. It's a J-shaped structure. It's a muscular bag located below a diaphragm in our body. And food found in stomach is now known as the chyme. As long as the food was there in the esophagus, it was a bolus, and once it moves into the stomach and after the action of certain enzyme, it changes into a chyme. After stomach, the partially digested food moves on to the intestine, which is a long coiled folded tube present in the abdomen, and it has the three parts, that is, I have already told you, duodenum, jejunum and ileum. Here you can see in the diagram below, duodenum is a very small light yellow colored structure, and bluish colored structure is the jejunum, and the pink one is the ileum, which is the longest. The small intestine is a very long tube around 7 meters long. It is long because here the absorption of the digested food takes place in the body with the help of special lining present in the small intestine. Small intestine extends into a large intestine, which has three parts, that is cecum, Cecum is a pouch at the junction of small and large intestine. Then there is a colon. Colon has three parts. As you can see in the structure above, it has an ascending colon, a transverse colon, and a descending colon. The colon ends up into a next structure known as the rectum. And rectum has two parts, as it is quite evident in the structure above. One is the rectum and an anal canal through which the food, the waste material moves out of the body. Now, moving on to the cells which secretes the enzyme which helps in the digestion. There are the glandular cells which are present on the lining of the stomach and the intestine, and they pour their secretions directly into the alimentary canal. These cells are present in stomach as well as in the intestine. Then there are certain glands which help in the digestion, such as the salivary gland, liver, and pancreas. They pour their secretion through a duct into the alimentary canal. Then let's move on to the salivary glands, the first glands. They are located below each ear is the parotid glands. Parotid glands are located below each ear on this side. They produces the watery saliva rich in amylase, which breaks down the starch. Then there is a submaxillary gland, which is present close to the inner side of the lower jaw, and it produces the water and mucus. If any of you have ever visited a dentist, you must have observed when you have to keep your mouth open for long, there is a lot of secretion of water, and that is the submaxillary glands and the sublingual glands which are secreting this substance. Then the sublingual lingual glands are present below the tongue and they produce water and mucus. Now, this is a diagram which shows the positioning of the various glands. You can see a yellow colored parotid gland beneath the ear and the sublingual gland that is present beneath the tongue and the submaxillary which is present near the jaw. Now, what are the functions of saliva? Saliva cleans the mouth cavity by killing the germs with the help of lysozymes. Then it also moistens and lubricates food, which helps in swallowing. Otherwise, if the food is dry, we won't be able to swallow it. Then the third is they produce the salivary amylase. It's an enzyme, and I think you all know that enzymes are all proteinaceous. They are made up of proteins. So this salivary amylase, it digests the starch and converts it into a sucrose. Sucrose is a disaccharide and starch is a polysaccharide. Polysaccharide means it is made up of lot many units of monosaccharides which are joined together. And disaccharide is a compound which is made up of by joining of two monosaccharide units. So the big molecule starch has been broken down into a small molecule sucrose with the activity of salivary amylase. Now, we have studied the one gland, that is the salivary amylase. Now we'll move on to the next gland, that is liver. You can see it's a brown structure which is present in the figure, and liver is one of the largest glands. Besides the digestive function, it has a very important role to play in our body. It plays a very important role in our body, and it is the largest gland. It secretes bile that is stored in the gallbladder. The green color structure beneath the liver is a gallbladder which stores the bile. Bile is not an enzyme. Bile is a salt which helps in the emulsification of fat. My next slide will show you what we mean by an emulsification of fat. And gallbladder will pour its secretion through the duct into the duodenum, which is a part of a small intestine. Then pancreas. Pancreas are present near to the stomach and they produce hormone insulin, which controls the blood sugar level, and pancreatic juice also is secreted by the pancreas, and they neutralize acid in chyme. Chyme, you know, the food that is there in the stomach. And some enzymes which break fat, protein and starches are also produced in the pancreas, and they are all moved to the duodenum part of the small intestine through a hepatopancreatic duct, which is a common duct for a liver as well as the pancreas. So bile as well as all the enzymes from the pancreas will move to the duodenum through a common duct known as a hepatopancreatic duct. Now, this slide shows the emulsification of fats. The light yellow colored structure is a fat, and the green small lines are the bile salt. What will happen? The big droplet of fat is surrounded by lot many molecules of bile salt, and this bile salt will break the big droplet into very small molecules, and on these smaller molecules now the enzyme lipase can act and break it into fatty acid and glycerol. This emulsification of fats, this leads to increase in the surface area on which the enzyme can act easily and break down the fat. With this, I think the structures which are involved, the body organs which are involved in the digestive process, and the glands which are involved in the digestive process, as well as the enzymes which ultimately helps in the digestion of the food, is quite clear to you. So with this, we end this session, and in the next session we'll go further on how the absorption and further breakdown of food and the absorption happens in an organism. Thank you.